So, characterization of steel cobordine for. We'll see as well. This is exactly how we work. And we will see what we did for cobordine in the single. About Stifel-Whitney classes, which are part of the term characterization theorem for cobordism. And in many books, you see definition of Stifel-Whitney classes by axiomatic definition. Axiomatic definition is very useful if you want to compute, but axiomatic definition does not say anything about the meaning of these Stifel-Whitney classes. And it's the same for chain classes in complex case. And I think it's necessary to know about the meaning of this Stifel-Whitney classes. The meaning, as with the obstruction theory, for example, it is one of the possibility to define Stifel-Whitney classes, obstruction theory. It's clear that it's very difficult to compute using obstruction theory, but you see very well what it means. And as I said, axiomatic theory, it helps you to compute, but it does not say anything about the meaning. So you need both definitions if you... it appears in many objects in mathematics that you need such two definitions, one for the meaning, one for computing. So obstruction theory is the following. If you have a manifold, M, that you with a triangulation k of m, you want to compute, and you have a vector bundle e with some n over m, and you want to construct r everywhere independent section of e of your real vector bundle. So how do you do? It's clear that over the zero skeleton, you can define an R section, a section of F everywhere, or F section in that point, in this point. And then you try to continue dimension by dimension of the simplices of your triangulation. So you have, for example, if you have one simplex, you have your R section here, your R section here, and you want to extend inside the one dimensional simplex. If you can do that, you continue till you meet an obstruction which says that you cannot go further. When you do that by induction, you let us assume that you succeed to that you construct your airframe, so your R independent, everywhere independent section, over the P minus 1 skeleton. And you want to extend to the P skeleton. So if you take a P-dimensional simplex, you have already your section on the boundary, because the boundary is P minus 1 in the P minus 1 skeleton. So you have already, and you have a map. You can define a map, gamma sigma, from this boundary of sigma, to the Stifel manifold of R linearly independent vectors in the fiber of E. Okay? So you have, if you look at the picture, you have your simplex sigma. On the boundary, you have already your R independent, everywhere independent section. So you have a section of this, of a bundle, which is a bundle of R independent section of your previous bundle E, and you have a section of this. Of course, if you take omega an open such that the bundle E is trivial over omega, so you have here a trivialization of your bundle, okay? And you can take the second projection on the fiber, which is the fiber of R independent section of Rn, because you know that E is being of rank n, the fiber of E is homomorphic to L. So you have such, you have a map from the boundary of sigma to VR. Okay, you have such a map. And you, when you have such a map here, it's a map from the sphere to VR, and so it gives you an element of the homotopy group. The homotopy group have been computed by people. In fact, you find this very, very clearly and very nice in the Steenrod book about topology of fiber bundles. And the homotopy of this Stiefel manifold is either zero, so that it means that as homotopy group is zero, so it means that if P is less than N minus R plus 1, you can extend your R section which is on the boundary in the interior of sigma. So no obstruction at all. But if P is equal to N minus R plus 1, you meet an obstruction because this homotopy group is either Z or Z2. This is a little more complicated in the real case because in the complex case is the first obstruction is always Z, but here is Z or Z, depending on. So you can define a Gaussian which associates to each P simplex an element in this homotopy group. So you have a system of coefficients, in fact, because this is either Z, either Z2. But if you reduce canonically to Z2, you can define classes in cohomology of M with Z2 coefficient. And this is exactly the Stiefel-Whitney class. Okay? So the Stiefel-Whitney class represents obstruction to construct independent section on of your bundle. When you have a when you take for bundles the tangent bundle to the manifold, to a manifold M, then the Stiefel-Whitney classes are called Stiefel-Whitney classes of the manifold. Okay. When you take for E this tangent bundle. Well, I give you just for fun the axiomatic definition of Stiefel-Whitney classes. And you see that if you take this definition, you see very well that you cannot see at all what is the meaning of these Stiefel-Whitney classes, and the two are necessary. As I say, this axiomatic definition helps a lot if you want to compute, in some cases, Stiefel-Whitney classes. So I will not spend too much time on this. Just one thing is that this Whitney product formula was there was some people who giving the formula but without proof, and the first very nice proof was given by Wu Wuvenson. We will speak a little more later on Wuvenson. So I will speak it. Okay, now the Thom theorem. So it is cobordism of spaces for the smooth space. So you can multiply. You can multiply this Whitney Stiefel-Whitney classes of M such that by the product, because they are in cohomology, till you reach a product which have dimension n, which is exactly the dimension of M, and you can take evaluation of this cup product on M. This is an element of Z2. And the first theorem is from Pontryagin. Pontryagin showed that if M is a boundary, then all these Stiefel-Whitney number, which are here, oh my God, all these Stiefel-Whitney number for all connection of K plus integers, all these are zero. So Pontryagin proved it in one sense. And it was proved in the converse sense by Thom in 1954. So the theorem is known as Thom's theorem. The corollary, of course, is that if you have two unoriented, I will not say always, but unoriented closed n-dimensional manifold, they are cobordant if and only if all the Stiefel-Whitney numbers for all collection of integers of Carl-Uppert, all these Stiefel-Whitney numbers are equal. Okay, so this is sometimes Tom theorem is known by this color here. Well, so let's go. So this is for cobordism of spaces in the smooth case. Let's go to cobordism of maps. This is, well, not so known. So first, you say that a map of dimension Mn is a triple Fmn with a continuous function from M to M. And by definition, we say that two maps are cobordant if two maps, so this, oh my God, so these two maps are cobordant if there exist a triple FVW. Of course, V and W give, each V gives a cobordism between M and M prime. W gives a cobordism between N and N prime, and F is a map from V to W, such that, continuous, such that the restriction to M is F, and the restriction to M prime is F prime, so it's a definition which is quite obvious not to give. Okay? So when you have a map, such a map from M to N, you can define the Gissing map by the following way. You take the map in homology, in dimension m minus k here, so you take the map which is induced by f in homology, the two Poincaré duality from m to n, but as they have different dimensions, of course, in cohomology, you will not find the same. So you find here k, because m is in dimension m, and n is in dimension n, so here you find k plus n minus n. So you find a map which is called as a Gissing map. Well, there are many other ways to define this map, but this is the most elementary. So you can define this map here, and we will use this map to send Whitney-Stifel-Whitney classes from M to classes over N. Okay. In fact, that is exactly what we do here. So you define the Stifel-Whitney number of a map, but in the following way. You take the Stifel-Whitney class of N, and you cut by image by this Gissing map that we have seen previously of Whitney classes of N, and for all collection, such that the sum of all will give you exactly N, which is the dimension of this. So you can evaluate on N, you will have a Z2 number. Okay? So this is the definition of a Stifel-Whitney number by Strong and other people. And the theorem by Strong is that two maps of dimension Mn are cobordant if and only if they are all the same Whitney, Stifel-Whitney number. So this is a theorem which extends the theorem for spaces to maps. This is always in the regular smooth case. In order to continue and to go before going to the singular case, we need some ingredients. One ingredient is what we call a Stinrode square, which is not so well known. And Stinrode, in fact, in 1948, defined Stinrode squares. He defined a lot of e-products, in fact, that are products going from cohomology in dimension k to k plus I in dimension. So I product goes is such a map, in fact. And in particular, among the I product, we have the Stinrode square, which is defined. The definition is quite rather complicated. The best I know is in the seminar carton using Cech-Durand cohomology. So it's Cech-Alexander cohomology. And it's quite, it should be 1 hour to explain this. So it's quite rather complicated, but it's very nicely made in seminar carton. But it's long, but it's very nice. So. In fact, if you want, as I said, some object in mathematics, you need some definition for the meaning and some definition for computing. And the unfortunately, the definition for the meaning is rather complicated, so I have no time to give you clear, but you can, if you are interested, go to the Carton seminar. Of course, it's in French. Maybe it's translated, the seminar Carton, I don't know. I think so. I think they are translated. No? And so you can go there, but here you have the definition of axiomatic definition of them, of this Steenwald square. Of course, naturality. SQ0 is identity when you have I is 0. SQN, if you take N and N here and here, the same index, N and N, then the Steenwald square is the cup product of X. Or X. And this is the reason for which it is this I product are called Steenwald square, because in that case it gives exactly the square, the cup square cup product. So it is zero in dimension minor, and this is the Carton formula. It is called Carton formula, but again, this formula was proved by Wu and Sun, and Wu and Sun say explicitly that it was Carton who gave him the formula. So these are the square products. Just remind that it is such a map. If you have such a map, so here is Wu and Sun. Wu and Sun is a he just died 3 months ago. He was 5 days before 98. And so, Wu and Sun made a first study in China, and he was a student of Chen. At that time, Chen was still in China, and before going to States. And but Chen sent Wu and Sun to Strasbourg in France, and so he worked a lot with Tom, so it's a reason for which all this is very related. He worked a lot with Tom and with Eresman, and then he worked in Carton. With Carton, he gave some lectures in the seminar, in the Carton seminar. And I had the pleasure to meet him 25 years ago, and to have a very fruitful discussion with him about characteristic classes for singular varieties. So it was a big pleasure. So, just the story. And so, the definition of these Wu classes, so we will define Wu classes, VI, and the definition is just, if as you have the Steenwald square going from cohomology to cohomology max plus I, okay, plus I, so you can imagine that this will be realized as a cup product by some class. You can imagine this, of course. And this is effectively the case. And this class, which realizes the cup product, which the square as a cup product, is called the Wu class. And it was invented by Wu. Okay. Let's go to the singular case. So I put this because I want to speak a little. So in the singular case, what are the problems? Now to go to the singular case. On the Tom and the Stone theorems. The first problem is that, as you have seen, we use cup product, and if you go to homology, this is dual to the intersection product of cycles. An intersection product of cycles is not defined in homology, in ordinary homology, if you have a singular variety. You see, there are counter examples very easy to see. That you cannot intersect, you have no Lefschetz Poincaré duality in ordinary homology if you have a singular variety. And this is the reason for which Goreski and McPherson invented the intersection homology that we will see a little. Intersection homology which helps you to recover intersection of cycles in the case of singular variety. And to recover, the Lefschetz Poincaré duality for singular variety. The problem, okay, so now you have intersection of cycles. The problem is that in this new theory, when you have a map, F and M to N, M and N being singular, in intersection homology, you have not automatically map in homology or in cohomology corresponding to F star that you have in ordinary homology. Okay, so you have not this map. in general. And even sometimes you have a lot of maps, which correspond, in intersynomology, will correspond to a map between spaces. And so it's necessary to go to some particular spaces, some particular maps, sorry, for example, what they call Placid or some particular cases of maps. And it, so you cannot work with any map. You have to say, okay, I will work with these maps, such that when you have my map between spaces, I have a map, a unique map, an existence and unicity of map between intersection and homology group of this spaces. Okay? So this is the second thing. And with these two, we can already work and we will see what will happen. Okay, so first we have to say what kind of singular spaces we will use, we will look at. And these singular spaces are pseudo-manifold. Pseudo-manifold, globally speaking, means that each n minus 1 simplex, so it is n-dimensional, each n minus 1 simplex is space of exactly two simplices. Why is this? This allows you to define a fundamental class. This is the reason for which you will work with pseudo-manifold. Why fundamental class? Because if you have a singular space which is triangulated, with this condition, each n minus 1 simplex is space of exactly two n simplices. If you take the sum of all simplices of dimension n, you are in Z2, so you don't care of orientation. So you take the sum of all sigma of dimension n, and you take the boundary of this. This should be a cycle, okay? But if, imagine that you have three simplices of dimension n, which meet along n minus 1 simplicity, when you will take the boundary of the three, you will find this n minus 1 will stay, okay? But if you have only two n simplices, which such that n, this n minus 1 simplex is the boundary of them, when you will take the boundary of the sum of all n simplices, this n minus 1 simplex will appear twice, for one and the other, not three or four, twice. So working is Z2 homology, this will give you a cycle. The boundary will be zero, okay? So this is exactly the kind of singular variety for which you have a fundamental class. Then we have to say what is n pseudo-manifold with boundary, because we work with boundary. So first definition was without boundary, now with pseudo-manifold with boundary. What is this? So first of all, x minus the boundary of x will be a pseudo-manifold in this sense here. And the boundary is a compact n minus 1 subspace which have a polaric neighbor. Let's look at the picture. It means that, for example, here, the boundary of x has a polar u, which is exactly the product of the boundary by 0, 1. Okay? Here, this is not the case. This here, if you take this polar u, will not be the product of the boundary of u by 0, 1. So this is okay, this is not okay. Okay? So this is a pseudo-manifold with boundary, this is not. It's clear? Okay? And so what you want is having a polar neighborhood of the boundary inside your singular variety. Okay. So now, this pseudo-manifold you stratify. We have already seen some stratification, so I will not spend too much time on stratification. In fact, the picture is much more. So you have your singular variety x, and then, of course, here, I am sorry that the singular part is not n minus 1, n minus 2 dimensional, but so the singular part is a cross. Okay? And then the singular part of the cross is a point. And so each time you take the singular part of the previous one. And the differences are the strata. So you know that already very well. And what is important is that each point X here I forgot to put the point X, has a neighborhood here inside X, which is like that, and which is the homeomorphic to the product of an interval, so it means a ball in the stratum, inside the stratum of it, by the cone over here, the cone over four points, and the cone over the link. So it here, the link is here composed of four points. Okay, so each point admits a neighborhood which is the product of a ball inside the stratum by the cone over the link, which is the transversal. Okay, so this is the definition of stratification we will use. And we use also perversity. I will not spend also too much time about perversities, but you will see in the next slide what is the use of this perversity. What is a perversity? Perversity is was invented by Goreski and MacPherson. And perversity, we say perverse in French, in English, in Portuguese, in Spanish. And it's very funny that in German, you say tolerance and instead of perversity. We will see why. So perversity is just a graph which either you can grow by one or you take the same than previously. Okay, you can either grow by one or take the same. What is that? Is only two possibilities. And this allows us to give a definition of what the famous intersection homology. I told you that we have to invent a new homology theory such that you can intersect cycles. And this is exactly intersection homology. Intersection homology, what does it mean? You take all chains in X, in your pseudo-manifold, okay? You take the chain you prefer. You can take the singular chain, you can take simplicial chain, PL chain, analytic chain, as you wish. Okay, so you take here is a group of chain you prefer, group of chain. And such that the dimension of the support of C with Xn minus C, Xn minus C is an element of this, of the stratification. Okay, so here is Xn minus C is here. An element here in this filtration. So the intersection is less than I minus C plus P of C. P of C is an element of this perversity. Okay, so this is a P of C. C is here. And C is here the codimension of the stratum. You see very well that if C and Xn minus C are transverse, the dimension of intersection of them, if they are transverse, is exactly I minus C. So P of C is a defect of transversality. You allow a defect of transversality. You allow chains which meets the stratum with a defect of transversality. And this, you need also to put the same condition for the boundary, otherwise you are not a complex. So you need a complex. For example, take here, in order to understand, take this picture and take this pitched torus. I cannot make a lecture without pitched torus, so here is a pitched torus. And so you have a stratification of it, which is very easy because you have X, and then A is a singular point, and so you have only one regular stratum and the singular point. And here, so you take A is n minus 2. Dimension n 2 minus 2, which is 0, okay, so C is equal to 2, C is equal to 2, B, you take this cycle B, B is one dimensional, so you have here 1 minus 2, and P of C, you see that P of C, P0, P2, P2 should be 0, okay? 0, 0, 0, and then you can do. So here, P of C is 0. So you have 1 minus 2 plus 0. But this dimension of B intersection with A is 0. But 0 is not less than I minus 2 plus 0. Okay, so This is not true. So B is not cycles in this intersection homology series. Okay? A is okay, but B is not allowed. So B will not appear in this intersection homology series. It's clear? No, this is the definition. Okay, so what are the property which will be useful later? First of all, you can intersect cycles exactly like you do. Forgot the P and Q. This is exactly the Lefschetz Poincaré duality. You have Poincaré duality between intersection homology, and you can have the same definition for cohomology with the same definition than before. And also, what is important is that I told you that if you take X pseudo-manifold, you have a fundamental class. So if you have a fundamental class, you can define a map from cohomology of X to homology of X by the cup product of this fundamental class, which is a Poincaré map, which is a Poincaré morphism, which is not anymore an isomorphism, like in the regular, smooth case. You have here a map, which can be subjective, it is not at all isomorphism in general. But this map, cup product by X, by the fundamental class, goes through, factorized through intersection homology. So intersection homology in between both. Okay? Okay, well, so now let's go to the Kovordim theorem for singular varieties. First of all, we can define Stimmel square operation in intersection homology. In this intersection homology theory, it goes. So you can extend. And this was made by Goretzky. So you have such a map. And if you have such a map, exactly like in the smooth case, you can define a Wu class such that this Stimmel square is a cup product by this Wu class. So you have Wu classes, you can define Wu classes, intersection homology Wu classes, exactly like in the smooth case. Okay. So these Wu classes are in intersection homology. In fact, you can also define Stifel-Whitney classes using these Wu classes. I don't explain it here, but the Stifel-Whitney classes, unfortunately, does not lie in intersection homology. They are not allowed cycles. So the Wu classes are allowed cycles in intersection homology. And this is the reason for which continuing cobordism with singular varieties, one uses Wu classes and not Stifel-Whitney classes. Okay? So the Wu class are in intersection homology. And you can multiply, taking intersection exactly with this intersection product here. This is an intersection product, okay? So you can define exactly, you can define the intersection product of two Wu classes, and if the sum of E plus G is N, then this is zero dimensional, so you take evaluation map, and you obtain a number modulo 2, okay? So you can intersect the Wu classes, and in the singular case, what is to remind is that we cannot use anymore Stifel-Whitney classes, but we can use Wu classes. And then you have this theorem with Goretzky and Pardon in 1989, saying the following: I did not say what is locally orientable space. I say this. Yeah, here. So you take, as I told you, you cannot work with any map, you cannot work with any space. If you want to work, you need to work with particular pseudo-manifolds which are locally oriented with space. What does it mean? It means that for each stratum, the link, you have seen the link previously, is the orientable pseudo-manifold. And for each stratum of codimension 2k plus 1, the intersection homology of the link is 0. these are technical conditions. But in that condition, you can define these characteristic numbers. Okay? Otherwise, you cannot. So now we can go to the Goresky-Parnon theorem. Locally orientable bit space of dimension n is the boundary of a locally orientable bit space, the same category, if and only if these characteristic numbers are zero. That we can call VU numbers, because now you have VU classes. And E, this is clear, this is clear, this is V1, the first one, power n minus e minus g. So intersection of them gives zero dimensional. So it's the points, they meet at points, and so you can take evaluation on them. You obtain this number. So you have this Goresky-Parnon theorem in the case of singular spaces. And this is the best we can do for singular varieties. Let's go to maps. So the definition of cobordism of map from it's more or less the same. Than in the regular case, but you have to take care of singularities. So first of all, a triple f x y will be null covariant if there exist v and w such that x is the boundary of v, y is the boundary of w, okay, and then there exists a map from v to w that is such that you have the famous scalar neighborhood of x and y. We have seen that in the definition of a pseudo-manifold with boundary, there is this scalar neighborhood of the boundary, so which are u for x and u for y, and this scalar neighborhood should be homeomorphic to the boundary of v times 0,1, boundary of w times 0,1, and this diagram commutes. So this is just the definition. And of course, the restriction of this big F here to the boundary of V goes to the boundary of W. So these are the conditions for having a map null covariant. So with this, you can imagine the definition of two maps being covariant. Well, so now, in the same way than for the regular case, you want to define a F exclamation mark in order to have a theorem similar to the Strong theorem. And the problem is that this, you have to go back. Here, so you see that intersection homology factorized here with this omega here, and this omega is induced by induction of chains. So this omega, which appears here, it goes from intersection homology to homology. What I did not say is that if x is a smooth, of course, everything is isomorphism here, because Poincaré is isomorphism. Okay? So let's go back here. So if y is smooth, then this is isomorphism, I just say now, okay? This omega is isomorphism. Omega is not. Omega x is not, but omega y is isomorphism. So you can define this map by commutativity of the diagram, if y is smooth. Y is because a smooth manifold. So in that case, you can define this map. And you can define this, you can define such numbers, VU numbers, using VU class of Y, the VU class of X, and you take image by this F exclamation. Okay, it is an exclamation with a tilde, but it's just going here, which are defined here, in order to go to cohomology of Y, because Y is smooth, so it's okay. So you have this F tilde exclamation. So you can define this number here, and you have a theorem which says you that, so the theorem will prove that if y is smooth, then this application fxy is null covariant if this map is null cobalt not, then this number are zero. The problem is that we cannot prove the contrary, the converse. If the number are zero, is to prove that the application is not cobalt not. This we could not prove, but when you see history, Podry-Hagen proved exactly in that sense, and Wernington proved 7 years later the converse. So we have 7 years to prove the converse. If you wish, you can try to prove the converse. And for the moment, we have no if and only if. If it's secondary, then the numbers are zero. So we have now to prove the converse. You can try if you wish. No problem. And I give you, in general, without this condition y being smooth, in that case, you can also define such numbers, but now you can use only three of them, because for some reason, in intersection homology, from this goes back to the perversity that I have no time to explain, but if y is any locally orientable bit space and not smooth space, then you can prove only that these numbers are zero and no more. Okay, you cannot prove it. Okay, so thanks a lot for you. I have still 2 minutes to say congratulations to Federico.
All right. Thank you very much for this interesting talk. Are there comments or questions? No, but and then I do have a question. One question is, you had these assumptions to be locally orientable with space and so on. And as I understand, you do your theory for differentiable or even continuous maps. Now, if you go to the complex analytic setting, how many of these assumptions are naturally satisfied?
The story is quite different. In fact, in the complex setting, you of course you have no cobordism in that case, but you have also, what is interesting is that obstruction theory, to go back to chain classes, the chain classes are also defined by obstruction theory. Okay?
Yes.
And in that case, the homotopy groups that you meet are all, the first non-zero homotopy group is Z always, not Z or Z2. Okay? So it's easier because you have immediately integer classes in that case. You have many possible definitions of chain classes. The first one, that is an interesting story, by the way. In the complex case, this obstruction theory chain classes, as they have been defined in 1965 by Marie-Hélène Schwarz, which is accidentally was the wife of Laurent Schwarz. They died, of course. And she did it in 65. And then Grothendieck and Deligne, they conjecture existence of chain classes in 1970. Later. But the fact is that Marie-Hélène Schwarz proves this in cohomology with support. Okay? And Grothendieck and Deligne conjecture existence of chain classes in homology. And this conjecture has been proved by McPherson in 1974 in homology. And then, with Marie-Hélène Schwarz, I prove that the classes of McPherson are the same as Marie-Hélène Schwarz defined in 65. So in fact, Marie-Hélène Schwarz proved the conjecture of Deligne and Grothendieck 5 years before they give the conjecture. And I think there are two examples in mathematics where you prove the conjecture before the conjecture. And that is a very nice example. So thanks to give me the opportunity to record this very nice thing.
Okay, further questions, comments? They did not come up with anything yet. So let's thank Jean-Paul Brasseur.